Well, in this lesson, we're going to continue on with probability. Probability is going to really form the basis of almost everything we're going to be doing from this point forward. In this lesson, though, we're going to talk about discrete probability distributions. A probability distribution is all of the outcomes that are possible from an experiment listed out. So for an example, if we were to toss a coin 3 times, that would be the experiment tossing the coin 3 times. What are the possible outcomes? Well, first off, there are 8 different possible outcomes. And if you look at the kind of the right center of the chart there, you'll see that the first time that I flip the coin, there are 2 possible outcomes. The second time I flip the coin, 2 possible outcomes. Third time I flip the coin, 2 possible outcomes. So in all, we have a total of 8 possible outcomes. So the probability distribution is going to be a listing of all 8 possible outcomes of this experiment. So now we're actually seeing a probability distribution. Here's the possible result, 8 possible results, and the number of heads that we could get with each possible result. So it is possible we could get no heads at all. And then tossing a coin 3 times, it is possible that we could have all 3 being heads. So we here see in this probability distribution the possible outcomes that we could have with each experiment. So we could get 0 heads, 1 head, 2 head, or 3 heads. After we have a probability distribution, the next step is to actually convert that into probabilities of each specific outcome. So, going back to what we saw just a minute ago, it is possible that all 3 of the coin tosses could result in no heads, tails in all 3. So, the X would be the result, or the number of heads. So, it's possible that if we got no heads out of 3 tosses, that could occur 1 time out of the 8 possible outcomes. Getting 1 head was a possible to get 3 different times, because the first toss might be a head, the second toss might be a head, and the other's tails, and so on. Getting 2 heads, there's a possibility of 3 out of 8, and the possibility of getting all 3 heads in 3 tosses would be 1 out of 8. There's only 1 out of the 8 outcomes, possible outcomes, that could get us that particular result. Now, a probability distribution has to come out to 100% or 1, and we can see that that is the case here. We have 1/8 plus 3/8 plus 3/8 plus 1/8 would equal 8/8, or as we convert them to the decimal equivalent, we end up with 1. So this is the result of a probability distribution, and we assign a probability for each possible outcome. One of the reasons of creating a probability distribution is to compute what we call the expected value. In other words, the mean. If we toss a coin 3 times, how many times will we expect a head to pop up? And so the mean is a little bit different than the way you've computed a mean before. Before, when you've computed a mean, you've added up all the values and you divided by n, the number. In this case, it's a little bit different because we've already done the division when we computed the probability for each outcome. So to compute the mean of a probability distribution, and we'll see an example here in a second, we simply sum up X, which is the result, times the probability of X. So if the result is getting no heads, well, that would be X would be 0, and the probability of getting that would be 1/8. If the probability was 2 heads, if the outcome was 2 heads, then it would be 2 times the probability of getting 2 heads. And again, we'll see that example here, but very different in the way you compute the mean than what you've done it in the past. Well, here we have an example from the textbook. So John sells cars, and he has tried to come up with a probability distribution of how many cars he expects to sell on any given Saturday. And for some reason, we'll just assume it's impossible for him to sell more than 4. So the probability of him selling 0 cars on any given Saturday is 0.1. Probability of 1 car is 0.2, and so on and so forth. And the probabilities all add up to 1. So we're going to then figure out what the mean or the expected value of this probability distribution would be, and we'll do that in the next slide. So here we see actually how to compute the mean of a probability distribution. Remember, to do that, you sum up X times the probability of X, X being the result. So looking at this little table, we have the result of no cars being sold. The probability of no cars being sold is 0.1. But of course, 0 times anything is 0. So that's an easy one in the column, the last column that you see there, X times the probability of X. We have 1 car being sold. The probability of 1 car being sold is 0.2. So that's 0.2. 2 cars being sold, and so on and so forth. So all we do when we're done is we sum up X times the probability of X, and we end up with a mean of 2.1. So we would expect that on any given Saturday, he would sell 2.1 cars. Of course, 2.1 isn't going to happen, but you know, somewhere between 2 and 3 cars. But that is the mean, the expected value, 2.1. And to get that, as you see, we just sum up x times the probability of x. After we've computed the mean of a probability distribution, we can go ahead and compute the variance. And you can see the variance formula here. First off, we're going to sum up the squared differences between each value and the mean. Now that should sound vaguely familiar because that's how we compute the variance in just about everything. But then we're going to multiply it times the probability of each value. We'll go ahead and see how this works with an example on the next slide. All right, so here's an example of how we compute the variance of a probability distribution. Again, we've already computed the mean, and so we take each value and subtract the mean, and then we square it, as you can see in that column, x minus mu squared, and then we multiply that times the probability. Finally, we sum it up, and we get the variance. And of course, to get the standard deviation, we simply take the square root of the variance. All right, now we're going to introduce you to the concept of a binomial probability distribution. When we're talking about a binomial probability distribution, there's only two possible outcomes. It could pass, it could fail, they could buy a car, they could not buy a car, they could buy a computer, not buy a computer, you could get a heads or a tails. And each of the outcomes are mutually exclusive, and each trial is independent. Now we'll go ahead and see how this works as we continue on with some additional slides. Well, here's your binomial probability formula, and it looks rather intimidating at first, but really isn't. But to make a long story short, you can compute binomial probabilities this way. There's also a really cool table that you can use in the back of your textbooks, and of course there's going to be a binomial distribution function within Excel. But let's go ahead and look briefly at this formula. We have a combination where n equals the number of trials, x is the random variable defined as the number of successes, and they've used in this this textbook, they use pi as representing the probability of success as opposed to a p. So once you have those variables, it's very easy to solve the binomial probability. Well, here's an example of using the binomial probability formula, and then we'll show you how to do it in the tables and also in Excel. So with this example, there's 5 flights arriving daily from Pittsburgh. Now, suppose the probability of any flight arriving late is 0.2. So we want to know, using a binomial probability distribution, what is the probability that none of the flights are going to arrive late. So in this case, x equals 0. So we have the number of trials being 5 with a combination formula, and the x being 0. The probability is 0.2, and so that solves, in this case, to a probability of 0.3277 that none of the flights will be late. All right, here you have an example of a binomial probability table, which you should find in usually the appendixes in the back of your textbook. So once I've found this, and this might be slightly different than what your textbook shows here, but along the far left column, we're looking at the n value. Now with the example that we had, there were 5 flights, so n was 5. Then we had to find the probability. And so we look in this case for the probability of being 0.2, which you can see highlighted the 0.2 column in this example. Then finally, once we have 5, we have the probability of success for each of the numbers of success. The probability of 1 flight being late, 2 flight being late, so on and so forth. And we can see that using the table with n equals 5, x equals 0, and the probability of being 0.2, we have a 0.328, which is just, you know, just rounded slightly different than what we saw when we did the formula longhand. Now on this slide, we see the same thing solved in Excel. And we can see that we have a cell that has the value of n in it, and a cell that has the value of p, or probability. And the function that we use in Excel is the binom dist. And that might vary depending on the version of Excel that you use. There might be a dot between the binom and the dist. But anyway, once you use that function, it's going to ask you, okay, what is the value for x, the number of trials, and finally the probability. The 0 on the end stands for cumulative, and we've seen cumulative a little bit here as in adding up the probability. So for instance, if we had cumulative being 1 and we were looking for the probability of two successes, it would also give us the probability of the one success and the zero success added together. But if we're looking for just the individual success, one, two, three, or four, we would use the zero on the end. And again, if you have some questions about this, please look at the Excel tutorials that are included with this particular lesson. Well, hopefully the formula to compute binomial probability didn't intimidate you too much, and you can see that we can use the table to do it real easily in many cases, or Excel. But when we get ready to compute the mean of a binomial distribution or the variance, you can see that the formula is very, very easy. To compute the mean, it's simply n, the number of trials, and times the probability. And you can see that the variance is almost just as easy. Now, we're going to go ahead and show you a couple of examples in the next slides of how easy it is to compute the mean and the variance of a binomial probability distribution. Okay, so using the example of our airline flights here, remember that the probability is 0.2 and that there were 5 flights. So what is the average or the mean? And remember, sometimes we use the terms expected or expected value. So to compute the mean, it's simply 5 times 0.2 or 1. So on average, we would expect that one flight would arrive late. The variance in this case is the 0.5 times the 0.2 times 1 minus 0.2, or when it's all said and done, 0.8. Very easy to compute the mean and the variance of a binomial distribution. This slide is just introducing us to what's coming in the next lesson here, when we're going to be talking a little bit more about normal distribution. And you can see that the higher the value are in, the more number of trials that we have, the more closely our binomial probability distribution approaches a normal or a bell-shaped curve. And that'll be an important concept that we'll cover as we continue with future lessons. Again, if you are curious about how to do some of this stuff in Excel, make sure you do pay attention to the Excel tutorials that are included with this course. But here you can see the difference between a cumulative probability and a non-cumulative probability with a binomial distribution. Remember, I said that if on the end, if you look at the function there in C5 and E5, that the first one has 0, the second one has a 1. And in column D, you see the cumulative function, because the function has the 1 on the end. It adds up to 100%, or all of the probabilities are taken care of. And of course, in column B, we see each individual number of successes, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5, and the probability associated with that particular number of successes.